Well, most of you know by now that I am the oldest of three brothers in my family. I came first, then 2 years, 9 months later came my brother Joe, and then some 9 years after that came our youngest brother, John. Now, John would have been 11 and a half years younger than me, and so it was quite a wide gap in years, and we lost John to a traffic accident in 1988 when he was only 20 years old, so he was the first of us to experience the glory of our Heavenly Father. Anyway, my brother Joe and I had a pretty classic older brother, younger brother relationship. We've enjoyed that most of our lives. We've always been very close, and we still are. I love this photo taken early in our lives together. My mom thinks we're definitely up to something there. I think she remembers something about that breakfast morning way back in time. But that closeness over our growing up years sometimes morphed into sibling rivalry. Anybody here ever experience sibling rivalry? Well, when I was 15, he was about 12 or so, we were out playing basketball one day at the hoop my father set up for us. And at that time in our lives, at 15 and 12, I was still bigger and stronger than he was and more experienced and so forth. So I was a better player, but he was, as a younger brother, fiercely competitive. And so we were playing one-on-one one day, and I don't know what happened. I can't really remember. We got into it. Almost anything could have happened, arguing over the score or pushing and shoving or yapping or whatever. And so one thing led to another, and we got into kind of a little scrape there. And for whatever reason, I felt it necessary to establish my position, my superior position, as the older brother. So being bigger and stronger, I sort of forced him back against this retaining wall behind our hoop, and I pinned him up there with one wall, because I was strong enough to do that at that time. It wouldn't be long before I wasn't, but I pinned him up there and held him so he was pinned. He couldn't move his arms, and I took my hand, and I just lightly slapped him in the face, not hard, just lightly, just enough on both sides, and I said, I can do this anytime I want. Sometimes you just got to do what you got to do, right, older brothers, huh? Well, I finally let him go, thinking I'd made my point, and I walked away, and I got about 15 feet away from him, and he winged me right in the back of the head with a rock. One shot, right in the back of the head, kind of to make his point. Any of your younger brothers here? You know what I'm talking about. Well, today we're going to talk about two brothers that we see in the Bible, but before we do that, let me bring you up to speed with where we are. Last week we took a break from the story of God, at least in Genesis, to look at the story of God in FBCG. Pastor Jeff laid out the vision that we have as a church family. If you weren't here last weekend or didn't get a chance to see it on video, go to our website. There's actually a page there now called Neighborhood Impact. You can watch Jeff's message. It's very exciting where we think God has taken us, but that's the story of God through FBCG. Today we're going back to the story of God in Genesis, and before we get started in this new series, let me bring you up to speed with where we've been. We started with a series called Beginnings way back in the late summer, early fall. Creation of the cosmos, creation of everything, creation of Adam and Eve in the image of God, and God blessed them with everything they needed in the Garden of Eden. Then came Paradise Lost, the fall into sin, and how the curse of sin has touched everything in all of creation. And then during the Advent season, we did a series called Promise, as we saw how God has promised throughout the early parts of the Bible to one day bring salvation and blessing into a broken world. And we saw that that promise was ultimately fulfilled in Christ, whose birth we celebrated at Christmas time. Now today we begin a new small series called Family. And the family we're talking about is the ancient family of a man named Abraham. Now you may remember that God had promised to Abraham to give him descendants when he was an old man and had not yet had children, promised to make him a great nation, and then through that nation he would bless the whole world. That's known as the Abrahamic promise of the Old Testament. And God did bless Abraham, gave him many children through a number of wives. Now, some of you have a question, how number of wives? Well, the whole question of polygamy in the Old Testament is not one I'm going to deal with today. It's a question for a different time. But he had lots of wives, lots of children. Those children went on to have their children. And so the God's promise to Abraham to give him descendants was certainly being fulfilled. But the most important of those descendants was a son named Isaac, the son of his old age, the son that they named Laughter, which is what Isaac means in the Hebrew. So he was born to Abraham and Sarah in their old age, and the story of God tracks the history of the family of Isaac, and that's where we are today. Isaac grows up, marries a woman named Rebekah. Isaac and Rebekah struggle to have children, just like Abraham and Sarah had struggled. Isaac then prays to God, begging for his own descendants, and then Rebekah conceives twins. So Isaac was evidently good at prayer. So we pick up the story, Genesis chapter 25, beginning in verse 22. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "Is it thus? Why is this happening to me?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples from within you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The older shall serve the younger." Now that's a very significant prophecy God is giving to Rebekah. We'll see that play out over the next few weeks and few chapters. When her days to give birth were completed, behold, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy cloak. So they named his name Esau. Now Esau, you have to know, in Hebrew means hairy. Okay, H-A-I-R-Y. After his brother came out with his hand holding Esau's heel, so his name was called Jacob. The word Jacob means he takes by the heel or he cheats. Okay? Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. Now, I pause here. I can't help but notice, as you notice, the very literal way these ancient people named their children. And I was thinking this week, what if we named our children like that? Like the first thing that came to your mind when you saw them when they were born. If that was true, our boys might be named like Lizard Boy or Pterodactyl Head or something like that. But they're not here today, so I can say those kind of things. So, but notice Esau was born first. Even though they're twins, he's born first, so he's technically the older of the two brothers. It's a significant detail. Verse 27, when the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man dwelling in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. I'm going to pause there. First thing I think we have to see, because it just jumps right out at you, is that this is a family divided. It's a Bible family, but it's a family divided. Any of you remember the movie made, I don't know, a bunch of years ago called October Sky? It was about Homer Hickam and the Rocket Boys, based on a true story. How Hickam grew up in a coal mining town in West Virginia, but always dreamed about becoming a great scientist. And eventually he becomes one of the pioneers of NASA and the space quest. But the story within the story, if you remember the movie, was about a father, a coal mining father, who had two sons. The older son was named Jim, and he was a football star, getting a football scholarship to college. The younger brother was Homer, who was more of a bookworm, gifted academically. And as the movie develops, you can see that the father clearly favors his older son, the football star, and doesn't really understand the younger son, who is more academically motivated. And as the story goes on, that divide threatens the whole family. As we've seen over and over again in our study of Genesis, the Bible doesn't hide the flaws of its heroes. That's important. Here we see parents who openly play favorites with their son. Isaac loves Esau most. He's a hunter, a man of the field, because Isaac likes the food he brings in. I mean, how shallow is that, right? Rebekah loves Jacob most because he's a homebody, stays around the tent, maybe helps her with cooking and so forth. But they clearly play favorites. It's a family divided right down the middle, a family that clearly is pitting these two brothers against each other right from the beginning. Now the story gets interesting. Genesis 25, looking at verse 29. Once when Jacob was cooking stew, Esau came in from the field, and he was exhausted. And Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stew, for I am exhausted." Therefore his name was also called Edom. Edom's a word that means red. Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright now." I'll explain the birthright in just a moment. Esau said, "I'm about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me now." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus Esau despised his birthright. Second thing we see after a divided family is what I'm calling a tale of two brothers. Two brothers. How many of you grew up in a family with at least one other sibling? Okay, many. Some of you didn't, but many did. So if you've grown up with another sibling or you've been the parent of at least two children, you know that there's a very human side to this story, that children who grew up in the same family, who share the same DNA, who might even look like each other, who share the same memories, can be very, very different from each other. Isn't that true? I started with a story about my brother Joe, but he and I are very similar. in many ways, but we're also quite different in others. We're similar, for example, in our love for sports. We both grew up playing sports. Our dad loved sports, so we both played multiple sports growing up, went on to play college basketball, and we enjoy sports of all kinds to this day, although we root for different teams. This fall was a particularly good time in my life because my brother lives near Cleveland. We actually got to watch a couple of World Series games together, and that was fun. You notice the one and the two that we're holding up there. We're similar in our sense of humor, although he may not find that funny. We share a calling. We share a passion for preaching and for God's word, for the church. He's a pastor in Ohio. And I've been told by people who've heard us both preach that while our styles are different, some of our mannerisms are very similar because you can't really control those mannerisms. We both share a commitment to marriage and family. My brother, in fact, just had his fourth grandchild born just yesterday. So I'm behind him in that manner. Not that we're competitive about things, but we're also very different. We have different personalities. I tend to be a little more introverted. He tends to be a little more extroverted. We're different also in regard to personal space. Neither one of us is very touchy. We're not very huggy guys, but he's what I call a close talker. You know what that is? He just stands a little too close to me. And it's all our lives. I've been backing up. Hey, just stay over there. Because he gets right up next to you to talk. He's also more of a risk taker than I am. When we were kids, he was just learning to ride a two-wheeler bike. I had learned a couple years earlier. One day, he tells the story. He was coasting down a hill next to our house, and he became fascinated with the front wheel. He was watching it spin. You know, he's on a two-wheeler. He's all excited. He's looking at the front wheel. And the idea popped into his head at like 6 years old. What would happen if I stuck my foot in the spokes? Yep. So he did. And he skidded to a stop on his face, came back to the house, just all scraped up down there, and that's how he learns things, okay? He still, to this day, is this amazing combination of curiosity and fearlessness. So Esau and Jacob are twin brothers, probably fraternal because of their appearance, but they're twin brothers, and they share some similarities, grew up in the same family, same mom and dad. We'll see later, they both long for the blessing of their own father, but they're also very different men. Esau is a man of the field. He's a hunter. Jacob's a homebody. He likes to cook. We also see that Esau is somewhat impulsive, that he's a man driven by his appetites. Jacob's more of a planner, a little more strategic, maybe even manipulative, always looking to get that edge, to get a leg up. He's sort of the competitive younger brother. Now, this part of the story hinges on our understanding of the birthright. The birthright in the ancient world was the special inheritance of the oldest male child. So the birthright involved two main elements. First, it was conferring on the oldest son sort of the spiritual leadership of the entire clan. And that was a big deal in those days. Secondly, it also promised the oldest son a double share of the material inheritance. He got a double portion compared to all the other siblings. So that's a big deal. Esau's been out hunting, maybe for days, comes home, he's tired and hungry. In his own words, I'm about to die. I'm starving to death. Jacob, coincidentally, maybe not, has this big pot of porridge or stew heating over the fire. I don't think it's too much to think that Jacob may have planned this interaction because he was just that way, as we'll find out. You can imagine the scene. The aroma's filling the whole tent. Esau is hungry. He wants some of that stew. Jacob, ever the opportunist, looks at his brother and says, how bad do you want it, buddy? Just how bad do you want it? Now, there are two ways to see this part of the story. First is to see Jacob as the bad guy, as being the master manipulator, and of course he is that. He finds a way to take advantage of his impulsive older brother, slightly older but still older, to get something that he desperately wants, which was he wants Esau's birthright, double portion of the inheritance, right? But before we get the feeling too sorry for Esau, we can't let him off the hook. We have to see that Esau was so impulsive, so driven by his immediate appetites, and so foolish that he sold his greatest honor, he sold his greatest source of wealth and security, his birthright, for a bowl of stew. Almost impossibly short-sighted. And we know this by the way the Bible describes Esau's decision. It says, and so Esau despised his birthright. Now that's a strong word. In the Hebrew, the word is bazah. It means to take lightly or to treat with contempt. So Esau despises his birthright by failing to value it and protect it. And in so doing, he despises, in effect, his own father, and he even despises the promises of God himself. We'll talk about that in just a few moments. So the rest of chapter 25, then all of chapter 26, if you're in a book club and you've read all over this, covers the rest of Isaac's life, including God's repeated promise to him that he's going to continue to bless him as a fulfillment of the promise he made to Abraham. And then we come to the end of Isaac's life in chapter 27. Chapter 27, verse 1. When Isaac was old and his eyes were dim so that he could not see, so he struggles to see, he called Esau, his older son, and said to him, "My son." And he answered, "Here I am." He said, "Behold, I am old. I do not know the day of my death. Now then, take your weapons, your quiver, and your bow, and go out to the field and hunt game for me, and prepare for me delicious food such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless you before I die." Now this is a big moment in the ancient world. Jacob's coming to the end of his life. He wants to make sure he gives his formal blessing to Esau, not only his firstborn son, but his favorite son. Now, the ancient custom of blessing is also a big deal. A little different than the birthright, but still a big deal. The father's blessing was a sacred moment when the patriarch of the family would pass on to the oldest son spiritual authority, his approval, and sort of this prophecy of prosperity for the rest of his life. To receive the blessing was a great honor. To lose that blessing would have been like being cursed, a terrible thing. The blessing affirmed the father's love. The blessing affirmed the son's role in leading the family. The blessing affirmed a future of prosperity for the son and his entire family. And by the way, it occurs to me that the blessing of a father is still significant today. Now, the blessings of motherhood are also very valuable and equally important, but this story is about the weight of a father's blessing. Father's blessing involves three things, at least three things, even in our culture today. Meaningful touch, hand on the shoulder, good strong handshake, slap on the back, maybe even a hug if you're designed that way. Father's blessing always involves spoken words of love. I love you. I'm proud of you. I believe in you. My guess is some of you here today are still longing to hear those words from your own fathers, spoken words of blessing. And then thirdly, always a picture of a special future. I think God has something great in mind for your life. Fortunately, one of the great blessings of my life is growing up with a father who gave me all three of those things and still does to this day, and I'm 60 years old. Dads, don't ever underestimate the power you have to bless your children. Now remember, Esau is Isaac's favorite. Jacob is Rebecca's favorite. Rebecca's in the tent. She overhears this interaction. She realizes that her husband, Isaac, is getting ready to bless Esau with this great blessing. And she comes up with a plan. Her plan is for Jacob to impersonate his brother, including wearing Esau's clothes so he'll smell like Esau, to put goat skins on his arms and on his neck so he feels hairy like Esau, so that he can fool his own father and get Esau's blessings for himself. That's Rebekah's plan. And it works. Back to the story, Genesis 27 now, beginning in verse 26. This is a long passage, so stick with me. Then his father Isaac said to him, now Isaac is now speaking to Jacob, dressed up like Esau, "Come near me and kiss me, my son." There's the touch part of the blessing. So he came near and kissed him, and Isaac smelled the smell of his garments and blessed him and said, here come the words spoken. "See, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field that the Lord has blessed. May God give you the dew of heaven." Here comes the promise of a prosperous future. "And the fatness of the earth and plenty of grain and wine. Let people serve you and nations bow down to you. Be lord over your brothers and may your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you and blessed be everyone who blesses you." Verse 30, as soon as Isaac had finished blessing Jacob, when Jacob had scarcely gone out from the presence of Isaac his father, Esau his brother came in from his hunting. He also prepared delicious food and brought it to his father. And he said to his father, let my father arise and eat of his son's game, that you may bless me. His father Isaac said to him, who are you? He answered, I am your son, your firstborn, Esau. Then Isaac trembled very violently and said, who was it then that hunted game and brought it to me? And I ate it all before you came, and I have blessed him. Yes, and he shall be blessed. As soon as Esau heard the words of his father, he cried out with an exceedingly great and bitter cry and said to his father, bless me, even me also, O my father. But he said, your brother came deceitfully, and he has taken away your blessing. Esau said, is he not rightly named Jacob? For he has cheated me these two times. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he has taken away my blessing. Then he said, have you not reserved the blessing for me? Isaac answered and said to Esau, behold, I have made him lord over you, and all his brothers I have given to him for servants, and with grain and wine I have sustained him. What then can I do for you, my son? Esau said to his father, have you but one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, O my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. Third thing we see in this ancient story is what I'm calling the undeserved blessing. An undeserved blessing. Years ago, I had a conversation with a man that I never forgot, and I've shared this several times because he's no longer in our church family. He was in his mid-40s or so and came to me wanting to talk about some marriage issues. And in the process of hearing his story, I learned some more things about his life. I learned that he was a nuclear engineer, had a very responsible job with an energy company. I also learned that he had a measured IQ of 170, which is extraordinarily high. This was an extraordinarily brilliant man. He could read 1,000 pages of technical manuals every day. And he told me, despite all that, despite all his accomplishments, and there were many, he had never been able to earn the love and blessing of his own father. He never could measure up to what his father expected or wanted of him and didn't know how to get it. And one of the great central pains of his life was never being able to earn his father's love. Now, it's hard to overstate the significance of the ancient blessing in this part of the world. It was the father saying, I'm proud of you. You're head of the family now. God's got great things for you. But it was even more than that. It was, you are blessed by God himself, who is going to fulfill his ancient promises to Abraham and to the entire world through you and your family. Listen again. May God give you the dew of heaven, excuse me, and of the fatness of the earth and plenty of grain and wine. Let peoples serve you and nations bow down to you. Be Lord over your brothers and may your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be everyone who curses you and blessed be everyone who blesses you. Now, I think we have to understand here that Isaac's blessing is an echo of the promise God made to Abraham, Isaac's father, when he said, I will make you the father of a great nation, and through you, I will bless the whole world. It's the same thing. We're going to talk more about that in just a minute. It's the promise of salvation. So the scene here is powerful, and it's poignant, but there's something wrong, isn't there? There's something wrong with the scene. He's blessing the wrong son. Isaac thinks he's talking to Esau, his oldest, his favorite, but it's not Esau. Jacob is impersonating his brother. He's wearing his brother's clothes. He's got goatskins on to feel hairy like his brother. And his mother is the one behind the whole thing, getting him to lie to his own father to receive the blessing. It's all wrong. We find out later that with this deception comes a brokenness between Esau and Jacob that lasts for 20 years. They don't speak for 20 years. So it's all wrong. Or is it? We find out if we fast forward in the story, we're going to get here in a couple of weeks as we continue on. We're going to see that it's Jacob who God chooses to give the name Israel. It's Jacob that God chooses to become the carrier of the promise of salvation to the world. For centuries, the Jewish people were referred to Yahweh, Jehovah, their God, as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, not Esau. So what do we make of the story? First of all, we have to see that every character in this story is broken. In fact, the whole story begins with a family that is split right down the middle, divided, dysfunctional to some degree. Mom and dad are playing favorites. There's no better way to create issues in your own kids than mom and dad playing favorites, right? Certainly God wouldn't choose this family to carry his promise of salvation to the world, but he does. So why does God choose this family? We all come from families of one kind or another. Some families are more intact. Some are more splintered. Some families may be healthier than others, but there's no such thing as a perfect family. There's not. Was your family messed up in some way? Well, join the club. Your family doesn't disqualify you from God's intent to bless you, from his blessing. Do you have issues left over from your mom and dad? Do you have issues left over from a stepmom or stepdad? Well, join the club. Your parents don't disqualify you from God's blessing. You still hurt or angry at a sibling? Someone do or say something unthinkable? Haven't spoken to one for years? Jacob and Esau didn't speak for 20 years. Esau said later after this event he was going to kill his brother after what he had done to him. Well, join the club if you have that situation, because your siblings don't disqualify you from God's promise. It's all here. Isaac and Rebekah play favorites. Jacob deceives, lies to his own father to get what he wants. Esau despises his own birthright for a bowl of soup. It's not a pretty picture. But I kind of think that's the point, if we understand it. See, I think God wants us to see that he chooses to work through this family so that we can know he will also work through our families. That he can bless us through even our families. I think God wants us to see that he chooses Jacob, even though he's been the cheater, even though he spent most of his adult life not needing God at all to get what he wants, because he wants us to see that our past failures and immaturities don't disqualify us from his blessing. I also think God wants us to see something in Esau. He wants us to see that it's possible to despise, to undervalue, to ignore, to turn our backs on what God is so trying to give us, his blessing and his salvation. So what do we learn? If the blessing is God's own approval, God's promise of salvation, then we need to see that God's blessing here that's being promised is Christ himself. Now, this is jumping ahead to the end of the story, but Paul, the apostle, makes this exceedingly clear in the New Testament. Galatians chapter 3, he says, "Now the promises were made to Abraham and his offspring." That's where we are in the story in Genesis. The promises were made to Abraham. "For in Christ you are all sons, children of God, through faith. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise." Do you hear that? So if Christ is the fulfillment of the promise, then when we put our faith in Jesus, we become heirs. Our inheritance is secure because we have a new heart. Through the forgiveness of sin, we receive new identity. We're now children of God, not bound by our past or our earthly families. We receive new purpose and a new destiny. That's the gospel. So therefore, I think these two ancient brothers, Jacob and Esau, represent what I would call two archetypes of how human beings try to approach salvation. Like Jacob, we can try to achieve salvation on our own, achieve blessing. We don't need God's blessing. We can get it on our own, thank you, by being smart enough, good enough, rich enough, accomplished enough, or we spend our lives trying to earn something that can only be received as a gift. Or, like Esau, we can despise the blessing of God, and that is simply to turn our backs on it. To ignore it, to worship our appetites and our immediate needs, to prefer to fill our bellies and our bank accounts more than knowing God's blessing and salvation. One or the other. So, are you more like Jacob, blessing yourself, or like Esau? It's not important to you. Other things are more important. Either way, what we need to know is this: God does not play favorites. He doesn't play favorites. His blessing is intended for all, but can only be received through surrender. And that begins, takes us into the rest of the story of this family. Will you bow with me as I close today? Lord, we thank you for this ancient story. Thank you for your story. And perhaps the best way for us to read and understand your story is to see it as our story too. For we are so much like these ancient characters. Our families are not perfect. And we are not perfect. But still your blessing is intended for us. You want to give us your blessing, your salvation. Teach us that the promise of your salvation is not limited by our failures or our families or our past. Your promise is anchored in your grace. And by faith, we can receive our inheritance. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Prayer team available if you'd like to spend a few moments in prayer about something happening in your life, the life of someone you know and love. Just come and share that time with us. We'd love to spend it with you. Here we go now in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whom all the promises of God are good. Amen. Have a great day.